This is a beautiful piece by Joseph M. Martin, The Wonder of Grace. It feels like something we should just all know, but it's newly written. The choir enjoys doing this. And on the flute this morning is the oboist, Lucy.
Token flute.
That's what the high notes are about.
Come to
reading this morning is taken from the book of Job, the 38th chapter. By way of introduction, at the end of the book of Job, after Job and his companions have argued about the cause of the great suffering Job endures, God finally speaks. These verses begin that speech, which is a grand vision of creation, describing God's ordering of the cosmos and inviting Job to marvel at its beauty. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind. Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? Or what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone when the morning stars sang together? And all the heavenly beings shouted for joy. Or who shut in the sea with doors when it burst out from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band, and prescribed bounds for it, and set bars and doors, and said, thus far shall you come and no farther, and here shall your proud waves be stopped. This is the first reading of the book. The psalm is on the back of your bulletin. I will read the light print and you read the dark print. This is from Psalm 107. Still the storm and silence the waves of the sea. Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good, for God's mercy endures forever.
Let the redeemed of the Lord proclaim, God hath redeemed them from the hand of the foe.
Gathering them in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south.
Some went down to the sea in ships, lying afraid in deep waters.
They beheld the works of the Lord, God's wonderful works in the deep.
Then God spoke, and the stormy wind arose, which tossed high the waves of the sea.
They mounted up to the heavens and descended to the depths, their souls melted away in their peril.
They staggered and reeled like drunkards, and all were filled with the holy wail.
Then in their trouble they cried to the Lord, and you delivered them from their distress.
You still the storm to a whisper, and silence the waves of the sea.
Then were they glad when it grew calm, when you guided them to the harbor they desired.
Let them give thanks to you, Lord, for your steadfast love and your wonderful works for all people.
Let them exalt you in the assembly of the people, in the council of the elders. Let them sing hallelujah. Second reading is from 2 Corinthians, the 6th chapter. Paul and his fellow workers experienced great hardships and even rejection while carrying out their missionary work. Nevertheless, Paul continuously proclaims that God has not rejected us, but is graciously working for our salvation. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on the day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness, for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet are well known, as dying and see we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything. We have spoken frankly to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open to you. There is no restriction in our affections, but only in yours. In return, I speak as to children. Open wide your hearts also. This is the reading for you.
The gospel verse can be found on page 179 in the front of your hymnal. Page numbers are at the bottom. Please stand. We'll say that hallelujah.
Good morning, I'm Fred Culbert, and today is the third part of the three-part talk on spirituality, my spiritual journey. And in today's talk, it's the spirituality of China. Dorothy's handing out some notes, and I don't know how we're going to do versus the number of people. And at the outset of the talk, I'd like to sort of go back and review the first two talks, because it seems like I'm kind of in a spiritual journey working from the small to the large. So the first talk on spirituality, which was very emotional for me, is called The Spirit of the Farm. And that is all by my early life on the farm here at Port Roberts. Lucy said it's okay to be emotional.
Thank you.
The second part of the journey is expanding out, and second to this time to the island of Bali in Indonesia, where I had the privilege of working for a year. And in Bali, the spirituality is literally with you every moment of every day. It's a very spiritual place. It's very easy, even for a cold-blooded engineer, to get in touch with spirituality in Bali. Today's talk on the spirituality of China obviously takes us from a small island to a huge country.
Oh, sheet.
Yeah. Andy, if you could, at this point, bring out the map. So everybody, does everybody have a copy of the notes? So today's talk on China. China is far more elusive when it comes to spirituality. It's obviously, as I think we all know, it has the largest population in the world. And if you kind of look down at the table at the bottom of the first page of the notes, the present population of China is 1,364 million people, 1.3 billion. And that's up a couple of hundred million from what it was 20 years ago. In terms of gross domestic product, next to the United States and the European Union, China is the biggest gross domestic product in the world, with a per capita number of $7,600 US per capita. So China has experienced remarkable growth over the last 20 years. The top of the page is a map of the People's Republic of China, and Andy has conveniently put it up here as well. And just for the record, People's Republic of China comprises of 23 provinces and also four cities that are actually big enough to have provincial status. Those cities are Beijing, Tianjin, Shanghai, and Chongqing. And also, like we have the Northwest Territories and Yukon, China has five autonomous regions, mostly in the more Arabic-oriented interior of the country, like Xinjiang territory, way up here, Tibet, places like that. And so that's pretty much, that's not very spiritual, but at least it gives us a bit of an outlook about China. Okay, Andy, I guess we can follow the map. In terms of religious beliefs, China is a multi-regional country and has been that way since ancient times. In one source that I read, it says that 85% of Chinese people have religious beliefs of one kind or another, meaning the remaining 15% are atheists. I'm not sure if that number is totally right. It doesn't really matter. It just shows that there's a lot of religious beliefs in China. So I've kind of made some notes, which we'll go over, on, I think it's the top five religious beliefs in China. First one is Confucianism, and that started around about 200 BC. It's basically an ethical and philosophical system, so it's not really a religion per se, but it developed from thoughts and was later treated as a belief to educate the common people. Here's a Confucius saying, we could probably find 100 of them, but this will do. Is it not a pleasure to have friends come from afar? Okay, Confucius says, so there we are. Confucianism is the soul of the Chinese culture. Where Chinese people stay or live anywhere in the world, there'll be Confucianism. Secondly, and I saw so many temples, and anybody who's been to China, Buddhism started 2,000 years ago. Buddhism has the widest influence and is accepted by most Chinese people. Buddhism influences Chinese culture on literature, art, and ideology. Basically, when you start looking at the types of Buddhism, there's three. The north is Han Chinese, which we're pretty familiar with. Way in the far west is Tibet. And then in the south is a different kind of Buddhism. So there's various factions of Buddhism, just like we have various types of Christianity. Taoism is another form of religion that started, these numbers are really around 1800 years ago. It influences culture, especially on such things as traditional medicine and literature. In literature, fictional characters are related to Taoism, one example being the Jade Emperor. Apart from the People's Republic itself, many Taoists live in Hong Kong and Macau. Moving up a little bit more, Islam, 1400 years ago, introduced to China during the Tang Dynasty. And I can imagine Islam came to China from the Islamic Arabic world as people started to trade and move across. I did a little bit of reading on it, pretty sure that's right. So I just put a little note, it's related to Arabic trade. Almost all Chinese Islamic folks are Sunni. Concentrations are, if we go back to our map, the interior of the country, Yangsha, Xinjiang, autonomous regions, Gansu, and Qinghai provinces. Those are all in the interior and the south of the country. Too bad Jim's not here. Christianity. So when I said I'd do this talk, my email lit up with an email message from Jim Linden. Fred! Oh. And then I've done a lot of research on Christianity. Damn, where is it? Not here. Anyway, I'll take a shot at it. Roughly 600 years ago, 600 AD, so that's 1400 years ago, Christianity was introduced again during the Tang Dynasty, and it was named originally Nestorianism. Did I get that right, Ben? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So who the heck was he? It was an Archbishop of Constantinople whose name was Nestorius. Nestorius? That's it. He lived about 400 and into the 500s AD. He was Bishop of Constantinople, and his influence created a church called the Eastern Church, and it eventually went to China, got to China. After that, if we go way forward, after 1840, Christianity spread over China, and that would have been thanks to the British, thanks to the German, thanks to all of the European colonialists who came to China. Next thing I want to do is to talk about different time periods in China. And when I started thinking about this, I thought, oh my God, I could go on for a very long time. So I tended to break things down into a couple of highlights. First, the early and middle ages. The early and middle ages would be kind of from 700 to 1600 AD. And the first thing I wanted you to know is that China is divided into the north and the south. And if you ever want to really learn about China, you need to get this book. It's called Lords of the Rim. And it's about the invisible empire of the overseas Chinese. So how did the Chinese begin to become overseas people and not just stuck in the Middle Kingdom? Well, the answer was, in very broad terms, related to the north of China, which is populated by the bureaucrats, and they didn't like the businessmen, the other guys, so they kind of pushed the businessmen to the south, and the south had a capital called Nanjing. In Chinese, Jing means capital and Nan means south. So the businessmen were suddenly pushed to the south of the country along the Yangtze River. Meanwhile, back in the north, the bureaucrats, the Confucians, folks like that stayed in Beijing. So in Chinese, Bei means north, and again, Jing means capital. So north capital, south capital, Yangtze River right in the middle. Very important geographic distinction in the country. Second thing that was really, by way of middle age highlights, important to me, and I read a whole book on this recently, was the Mongol invasion that started in the 13th century. So the Mongols came to China under Genghis Khan. They basically came in from the north, they took Beijing, and they took a lot of the rest of the country. Their empire actually extended at one point, the Mongol Empire, from Korea all the way to the Danube River in Europe. They controlled that whole area. But China was one of their most important possessions. And after Genghis Khan, there were a number of his sons. They set up dynasties, they had emperors, they were very important. And I think the Mongol invasion kind of cemented a lot of the Arabic influences in China, especially in the far west. Second thing I wanted to talk about, it's actually kind of interesting, it's on this page, there's a picture of a man at the top. It's a person by the name of Admiral Zhang He. And he was an admiral of the Chinese Navy, he was the admiral. And this was in or about 400 to 500 AD. This man was also known as Sanbao the Sailor. Does that relate to any other name you know? How about Sinbad the Sailor? So Sinbad the Sailor is really our way of saying Sandbad the Sailor. So he's the man. He started his life in the southwest province of Yunnan, which I think is where Moss King came from. And he was the son of an Arabic family. And his grandfather had been on the Hajj to Mecca, so his spirituality was very much in the Arabic Islamic world. And at that time, they castrated a lot of young men. And at the age of 13, he was castrated and became what is known as a eunuch. And a eunuch in the imperial court, he was taken to the imperial court. And he actually proved to be a really handy guy. And in mythology, it was said that he was 8 feet tall and 5 feet around. I think that's probably an exaggeration, but nevertheless. So he was then, the emperor then eventually appointed him the admiral of the whole fleet. So on the Yangtze River, they put together a very big armada of things known as the treasure ships. And the map at the bottom, you've got it in color, it's a little better, shows that the three voyages that they made in the 1400s. They basically connected to it looks like Bangkok down the Vietnamese coast, down to my old territory in Java. I know they went to Semarang, to Batavia, up the Strait of Malacca, over to, Ambon, and then all the way up into the port of Chittagong in the north, where I've been, and down to Ceylon or Sri Lanka, over to the Indian continent, then over to the African continent to Mombasa, and then up into the Arabian Peninsula to various places. In one version of the story that I read, his fleet contained, I think, 28,000 men. And when they showed up, they had a huge influence on not only the spirituality, but everything in the world that they went to. The importance of Sandbad the Sailor, he took the Middle Kingdom and moved it out. And that really started the power of the overseas Chinese, who bring their influence and their culture to many places in the world, including recently Point Roberts. It's true. So let's move ahead. I thought, okay, oops, we'll just skip ahead to the 20th century, because I have a few things to say about the 20th century in China. And I divided it very crudely into the first half and the second half. So during the first half of the century, the 20th century, China was basically in chaos. Everything I read about it at that time talked about warlords, talked about nationalists, talked about Sun Yat-sen, Chiang Kai-shek, and eventually into this came the communists and their attempt to bring their part of their thinking into the Chinese life, which they did. And then, unfortunately, the invasion of the Japanese, which really caused huge problems. It was a horrible time. But during that time, two men from Point Roberts actually journeyed to China. And Sylvia, your father was one of them. I've got that Logie Thorstensen, that's Sylvia's father. And Jonas, who's Joan's dad, went on a merchant ship and they went to, Sylvia, do you remember?
Shanghai.
So that would have been about 1923-ish, give or take. Amazing. They went to the Philippines, they went to Japan. As far as I know, they're the first Icelanders to go to, let's say, to China. At least from here. Yeah. Lots of other highlights during the first half of the 20th century, but one that actually provoked me to read a book, which I don't do very often. There's a man by the name of Dr. Norman Bethune. Canadian. Is that name Gina's giving one of those, or she's joining me? Do you know Dr. Bethune? Yes. Anybody else? Does that name?
Yeah.
Abby?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Where do you go? Okay. So I was in China 20 times and worked there for on and off for 10 years. And everywhere I went with my colleagues, and people would say something like, "You are from Canada, you must know about him." Oh, who's him? Not a hockey player, but Norman Dr. Bethune. So I thought, oh, I need to find out about this guy. So he was a very big, he wasn't a spiritual man per se, but he brought the spirit of Western medicine to the army of the communists under Mao Zedong. And they were fighting not only the nationalists. One day Chiang Kai-shek and the boys would show up, and the next day it'd be the Japanese. And he taught them how to run mobile hospitals, which were sometimes only 6 hours ahead of the Japanese. He performed heroic surgeries day and night. He taught the Chinese people, and he became, I think, next to Mao Zedong himself, second most important person during the communist drive to Beijing. And sadly, who knows what happened to Dr. Bethune? He died. He was doing surgery in one of the field hospitals, and he cut himself during surgery, which is kind of unusual for a surgeon. And then the septemia or whatever it is set in, and they couldn't save him. And when it happened, the Chinese were devastated. But they carried on, and under Mao Zedong, they took the capital of Beijing in 1949. And of course, we've all seen the picture of the great man in front of Tiananmen Square, on the balcony of Tiananmen Square. Let's go to the second half of the 20th century. And when I was there, I was there during the last part of the communist era. And I say that because I think really the communist era ended when China got Hong Kong back. And now we have a different name called market socialism that's going around with really big suits on and all that kind of stuff. But during the 50 years of communist rule, it was a brutal time, brutal, brutal, brutal time. Did anybody see some of the programs on public television the last couple of months on the communist era? It was terrible. But I kept thinking it was brutal, but after this period of chaos, it kept order in the country. So at least it kept people disciplined so they didn't all fly apart. Fast forward, Dorothy went to Tianjin in 1988, get that right, and stayed until 1989. So lo and behold, after Romy and Jonas, our next visitor to China is sitting over there, my wife. And she left there, was it just before the Tiananmen Square? Just got out. Okay. So finally, I got there in 1994, and on and off over 20 visits to 2004. And I was part of an international program sponsored by Canada called the China Transportation Training Program, and this is where I had a chance to interact with a lot of Chinese people. And it struck me during that point in time that the return of Hong Kong was basically an emotional high for the Chinese people that ended a period of 100 years of humiliation. They were humiliated when the colonialists took Hong Kong, and they were so glad to get it back, and it reopened their culture and it created a lot of positive energy. The last thing I wanted to put in the notes, and this is where I wish Jim Lee was still here, Christianity returned to China after the end of Hong Kong, the return of Hong Kong. So now, instead of Mao Zedong, we've got Deng Xiaoping, the opening of market socialism, and I can tell you that in the little bit of reading I've done so far, that the return of Christianity has been well spread in China. So that concludes my talk on the spirituality of China. I found this talk to be a lot more difficult than the first two, mostly because the subject is so big, and in China, spirituality is elusive. You have to look for it to find it. Although every city you go to, they'll definitely take you to a Buddhist temple if you want to see one. Thank you. I think we have the, I actually made a request for the hymn today. I think Jonathan's going to queue it up, and we'd like some audience participation.
Just as we're getting that ready, can I ask a follow-up question, Fred?
Sure can. Don't make it too hard.
Why did it feel important to bring China to us?
Because China represents the last part of my spiritual journey, Tosh, at least at the professional level. And I'm normally a cold-blooded Excel spreadsheet engineer, so when I can see and touch a little bit of spirituality, it actually affects me more than you know.
Yeah.
Is that an elucidative message?
That's right.
And Fred, you also you alluded to a Chinese presence here in Point Roberts.
I did. Remind me what that was.
Oh, yes.
Thank you.
Neighbors.
Yeah. So, yeah, neighbors. Another, the original, just put this in, the original Chinese presence in Point Roberts actually was at Lily Point. Okay, the cannon. Right. So there were, on at least a seasonal basis, several hundred Chinese workers who came to Point Roberts to work that cannery. And just again, Sylvia, the farm, maybe a bit of a last minute connection. Your father and grandfather, as I recall, used to take milk and carts up APA Road all the way down the cliff to sell to the Chinese in the bunkhouses. And there was a lot of Chinese people who packed a lot of salmon in this place. The hymn of the day, I think you, some people may have the words, and I don't want you to sing necessarily the verses, but if you could chip in the chorus, that would be great. The song is written by Neil Young. It's called When God Made Me.
Just clean his image, or a